Okay, let's start. So my name is Sergey Nikitin, and my talk is devoted to some properties of telecom processes, especially on its large deviations. And it's a joint work with Mikhail Lifshitz. So first of all, I will introduce telecom processes via the model of a service system, and it also will give us some motivation why do we consider such processes. So definition of a service system: we have a space of of a service process. Every process have three parameters. First is a starting time, the start when our process starts, duration, how long our process is active, and required resources is how many resources do we need to spend to serve this process. And we want to construct some random measure on all of our service processes. And there is some measures on all parameters. On starting time, we have arrival intensity. So on during unit interval, there arises lambda, in average, there arises lambda new process. And we have a distribution for duration and resource. And also I should mention that that process starts somewhere on real line. And of course, for duration and for resources, I have that they are positive. No, it's logical. So, and we suppose that these distributions are independent, and by this form, that intensity measure is just product of this measure. Yeah, of course, we could consider, for example, joint distribution of U and R, and it would be a little bit different model, which is actually more logical in practice, because of course duration and how many resources do we need to spend is somehow correlated, but here they are supposed to be independent. So and we define a Poisson random measure with such intensity, and all service system will be this pair of our space of processes and this measure. So what do we got is that every process arises with some intensity, quite natural model. So I can for every finite set, every finite set corresponds to a random variable with parameter equal to measure of this set, and if sets does not intersect, that variables are independent, and that's exactly yes, it's a set of random variables for every finite set on R space. And for every space, we have a random variable with parameter measure of this space. Yes, it's Poisson random variable with parameter measure of this set. And if two sets does not intersect, then they are independent. It's enough in this case. Okay, maybe. I believe it's not important. I mean, okay, we have our space R, yes? And for every finite set A, every finite set have some random variable, NA, which has a No. Okay. And I will use integration over this random matter. So, of course, as a for such system, we're interested in its in a workload. And what is very cool about such systems that we can write workload at some time via such a stochastic integration of with respect to this Poisson random measure, and it will write. It writes this way. We can understand this integral just like a sum of values of this function on some random configuration, which on some random process, which arises with respect to defined intensity mu. So it's what exactly is written here is that inset workload is just a sum of required resources, which are active at time t. And we, of course, we are interested on how many resources do we need to spend during some period of time. And it writes just an integral over just usual Lebesgue integral of instant workload over some period of time, and after some evaluation, it also gives us some stochastic integral with such a function, and function L here is just indicates for how long our process is active while time is positive. So of course, if our process is active when time is not positive, it does not contribute to our workload. So it's quite natural. So, what? S is not a parameter. S it's a parameter of a function. So it I should write it actually this way. And yeah, what we are integrating over this. Maybe it should be written this way. This is a function of S R and U. It depends on S, U, and R. Yes. What? Yes. No. T is a variable here.
Depends on the
Вот это вот. This S is a parameter. Yeah. This is a function on space R. Okay, so and yeah, if we so okay, we got the expression for got an expression for integral over quad. So okay. And here some limit theorems arise. Oh, да, and to do that we have to assume that our distributions of duration and the resources have some have regular tails u with parameter gamma and some use parameter gamma which is smaller than two, or there is a one distinct case when gamma is formally equal to two. It means only that their dispersion is finite, and also we have the same for resource distribution with a different parameter. So and actually only here we can say that integrals which was written page before was well defined, because of course the stochastic integral does not exist for every function we integrate, but in these conditions, we have that at first their expected values are finite and the integrals are correctly defined. So, and here arises some limit theorem, and formally to achieve it, we need to scale our time, and then we need to centralize our process and divide by normalize, no, so divide by some factors, which depends on our coefficient of speed of time A and intensity. Lambda corresponds to intensity. And that's exactly what I said. This expression is expected value of integral workload. It can be evaluated. And we divide by some factors which we may switch. So, and why is this limit approximation arises? Because this result describes the initially that work was devoted to some network system. I mean, original work of this service system, and this limit results describes the random variation in traffic patterns. Which corresponds when the larger volumes of traffic being transmitted over larger networks of higher capacity. And limits when that's exactly what happens when we speed our time and also speed intensity. So, and there is some we may tune our parameters, and of course with different limit of ratio between intensity and speed of time, we may achieve different results. And actually this ratio written below is actually with some coefficient, a number of processes which was active at time zero and still active at time A. So it's a very, very long process. And in case of where Poisson telecom process arises, this ratio is bounded and tends to not to zero. So yeah, it's important that L is non-zero. So, and the limit theorem for Poisson telecom process if we have such a parameters gamma and delta, gamma is strictly smaller than delta, delta may be equal to 2, and we have a critical intensity conditions which are exactly this expression. So here we have here our normalized integral workload converges to our Poisson telecom process, which admits this representation. Yeah, and by definition, this convergence is just a convergence of finite dimensional distributions of one process to those of another one. So, and in result, in this limit, we have our Poisson telecom process, which admits such an integral representation. Yes, where n with bar is a centered Poisson random measure, having intensity written below, and it depends on three parameters. First one is gamma. Second is a constant Q. No, actually, constant Q just scale all process, and resource distribution R. And in origin, we assume that R has regular tails, but from now on, we consider all cases for all R. This is a strict theorem, yes. Which one? This one. This is a parameter of distribution of duration. We have our normalized integral workload process where constant L is appears in case of critical intensivity. Yes. Yes. In this theorem, A and lambda goes to infinity with this proportion. Yes. And Cu is a parameter of distribution of U.
Yeah, I think that everything was defined on previous slides.
Yes,
and
everything.
This is like fine for the presentation kind of theorem, and not like, because it's not like a paper, it's a presentation. So
U is a variable for duration. I mean, distribution of U has a regular tails, which means exactly what is written. All we need is that U has this distribution. Yes, yes. Large appears in R proportion. What? Lambda is another parameter of the system. It's intensity for starting time. Yes, there is a lot of parameters. Here lambda and a goes to infinity. They changes and go. Lambda is parameter. И parameter might change. It changes and goes to infinity. And having different lambda, we have a different process. Okay.
Please continue.
So here our coefficient a is a speed of time in our parameters at a, and if we have this proportion between original previous page between a and lambda, then we have such a convergence to such a process having a integral representation over this centered plus and random measure. Yeah, as I said before, it depends on only three parameters. First one is gamma here, and resource distribution R, and constant Q, which does scalar results. And here it's start of original work. We're interested in its large deviation. But first of all, I have to mention some properties of this process, and it is known that this process is defined well if gamma momentum of resource distribution is finite, and this process also has stationary increments, but it's not self-similar like all other limit processes which arises alongside. And at large time scale, it behaves like a gamma stable Lewy process. By that, I mean only this statement. If we normalize our processes this way, then we have such a weak convergence to some strictly stable random variable. Which defines this way, having this characteristic function. And it's also a known result. So, and here we need, from here we can achieve that for some, if we fixed some level rho, and it can be written that our deviation of our processes has this asymptotic. It's just a corollary from this theorem. Actually, here no condition. It's all we need is here. No, except for definition of process Y. Of course, we assume that if everything is well defined, then we have this. Yeah, so, and one corollary is this form of some deviations when rho is fixed. And we are interested in its large probabilities, which we define this way. So we are interested to find asymptotic of this expression when rho and t both goes to infinity. And we have to require that rho is much greater than 10 power 1 divided by gamma. Otherwise, that expression won't tend to zero, and it would be a different problem. So here we distinguish three different modes of deviations, which gives us different results in different asymptotics. For the first case, we assume that rho is much smaller than t. For the second one, we assume that rho level of deviation rho is of order of t with some coefficient kappa. And the third one is a case when our level of deviation is much greater than t. So then they both go to infinity. No, and we solve first two cases and three for some insertion case. So the result for the moderate regime, we call this mode of deviation moderate when rho is small compared to t. So I will use a terminology from background solar system, and we have such a theorem that when rho and t goes to infinity and such a condition holds, then for large deviation we have such an asymptotic. And as you can see, that asymptotic order is like in the case when rho is of order 10 power 1 divided by gamma. By this I mean that their limit of their proportion goes to zero. It is uniform when t goes to infinity compared to t. No, of course, it depends on convergence, on tempo of convergence. How much rho smaller than t? Okay, so of course, we can see that distribution of R does not depend. That asymptotic order does not depend on distribution of R, only constant depends on distribution of R. And actually, in this case, it's kind of informally at this moment that this deviation level, asymptotic in this deviation level, achieves by the case when there emerges one big, quite large service process. By quite large, I mean in terms of R kernel function. I mean kernel function. I will mean this function over which we integrate, which this function in the integral representation. Of course, if we have a process which with a high, on which this kernel has a high value, that this process contributes a lot to the integral, and in this case, big deviation reaches by only one big service process. And so in intermediate case, when rho is of order t with some coefficient kappa, there arises some different situations for and the number of processes which we need to reach the level of deviation might be different. It depends on is distribution of error bounded essentially or not. Because our kernel function works this way that may be bounded, and of course by one process we won't be able to reach deviation. There might be no chance, but if rho is not significantly bounded, by that I mean that there is a probability that rho is greater than kappa with non-zero probability, and to avoid some technical difficulties, we exclude the case when there is a lot in a point kappa of distribution R. And in this case, when rho is of order T with the coefficient gamma, we have such an asymptotic with a bit more nasty constant. Again, it's quite the same actually for the previous case, and as we can see here, this case covers almost all good cases when R is, for example, is not bounded. For example, when R is not bounded and continuous. And here. But order of asymptotic is actually the same as in the previous case.
Can you please say what is L, which stands in dL to the power of one?
Which one? It's one. Yes. Gamma, our process is defined for gamma from 1 to 2. And for that gamma, it's positive. And of course, gamma moment of R exists. Otherwise, it won't work from definition. So, and for the case if R is not bounded, if R is bounded by is bounded and we can't achieve R deviation by one process, it the idea that we can achieve R deviation level by minimal number of service processes by which this deviation can be achieved. This idea works that arising then asymptotic achieves by arising this number of service processes. Yes, and the same restriction for R. So. And of course, we exclude some lots. Otherwise, of course, would be possible to achieve our deviation by n processes, service processes, but it won't mean there is some negative contribution. And in these cases, everything depends on behavior of R near point kappa, and in asymptotic it there might appear very very different results. So we exclude that case, and here we have a different asymptotic. It's compared to previous one, it's just in power of n to the previous one, but with different constant, and the constant is really messy here, and I won't show you. But of course, this constant just depends on on coefficient kappa, number of processes n, and distribution of rho. Yes, and the last regime is when rho is much stronger, much greater than t. So here it's not true that we asymptotically achieve our deviation by a minimal number of processes. And here, some essential cases of R, for example, exponential, it's true that number of processes by which large deviation is achieved goes to infinity. But it's not, but it's out of range of our work. And here we solve the case for one essential case when distribution of R has a regular tails of some order. No, this is the only restriction that order M have to be greater than parameter gamma. Yeah, of course, in this theorem, we assume that R process is well defined. Gamma is from 2 to 1, and here we have this formula. And of course, even asymptotic order now depends on distribution of R. And actually the constant is quite nice here. So we have a result, and actually in this case, only in this case, we achieve our deviation asymptotic achieves by emerging only one big enough process. So and something about formal ideas of proof. So we have a initially we have an integral representation, which we by definition we can divide into some parts, where our kernel function is big enough, and where our kernel function is not big enough. Actually, the intensity measure on the range when our kernel is not big enough is infinite, but we can deal with the first integral using only general inequality, general probability inequalities. And for the second one, we have the third term here is just a constant, which depends on h and t and rho. And for the main term here, we can represent it as a sum of values of function of t on some random configuration on the surface process which arises with some intensity on our range. But what is important here is that intensity measure on integration zone of y1, it's the second term, is finite. That means that there arises only finite number of processes, and so it gives us a possibility to estimate this integral, deviations of this integral by probability with how probability some process arises, and that gives us almost all the results described here. And actually, that's all what I wanted to say. And yeah, that's the last page. It's all just a reminder of definition. Yeah, that's it.
Any questions? So the question is, where is the, like, could be applied?
Yeah, it originates from research of network models, and let them say that this limit process arises some patterns of traffic when intensity of our traffic raises with some proportion with capacity of network, and that's exactly what limit theorem give us, and that's I believe where it is applied. I don't know.
There are actually many ways to be connected, and it's a usual story. I don't know about this, but maybe it was on what's the difference, but for those of us.
So let's thank the speaker again.